This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. The South Dakota sky on a clear night is a thing of beauty and wonder. South Dakota places and people have been making significant contributions to aerospace engineering and space science since the very beginning of the space age. Some would say that the international race to space started in South Dakota in a sheltered valley southeast of Rapid City. Here in 1935, two Army airmen taken aloft by a helium balloon rose to an elevation of nearly 14 miles above sea level. They performed scientific experiments and took the first photograph to ever show the curvature of the Earth. The view is to the west over South Dakota farmland to the Black Hills. During the Cold War, South Dakota was at the center of America's missile defense strategy. Underground silos housing intercontinental ballistic missiles dotted the landscape west of the Missouri River. Since the early 1970s, a U.S. government facility near Sioux Falls has been accumulating and archiving images of the Earth as seen from space, providing an inventory of natural resources and documenting decades of landscape change. South Dakotans worked on the rocket technology that launched the first American into space, put John Glenn into orbit, put the first men on the moon, and got them safely off the lunar surface and back to Earth. There are astronauts with ties to South Dakota, and there are those working on strategies and tactics for new spaceflight missions, working out the details of human travel to the moon and eventually Mars. Nobel Prize-winning astrophysics research that began in the 1960s continues nearly a mile deep in an old South Dakota gold mine. And South Dakota young people continue to enter careers in science, technology, engineering, and math. A new generation poised to take over where previous generations left off. By the 1930s, scientists knew enough about space to be able to ask questions. What could observations from the edge of space reveal? What secrets of the atom might be discovered? The search for those discoveries was the start of the space race. By the beginning of the 1930s, other nations were ahead of the U.S. in terms of high-altitude exploration. They pursued their own scientific interests and left a lot of questions unanswered. Army Air Corps Captain Albert Stevens wanted to do more. Stevens sought funding and support from the Army, but was only promised logistical support and manpower. Stevens contacted the National Geographic Society, which shouldered the cost of his plans in the name of exploration and the reporting of it.
This is really where the experimentation and really where the altitude records made a big difference in the scientific research and the first step towards space.
A major expedition was organized. The Army assigned a three-man crew for the flight. Major William E. Kepner, pilot. Captain Orville Anderson, alternate pilot. Captain Albert Stevens, scientific observer.
Primarily, they wanted to study cosmic rays and what effect that has on humanity.
Stevens and Kepner were dispatched to locate a suitable site for a balloon launch. They chose an unusual landscape feature in South Dakota's Black Hills, a flat piece of protected ground surrounded by tall, steep cliffs. Calling on the resources of the South Dakota National Guard, Anderson directed construction of a camp in the gorge. The so-called Strato Camp served as construction site, mission control, and launch pad. A balloon manufactured by the Goodyear Zeppelin Company in Akron, Ohio, was ordered and delivered. The balloon would be taken aloft by hydrogen. The expedition was ready to go in early July, but weeks passed as Major Kepner waited for perfect weather conditions. Finally, on July 27, 1934, the order was given to prepare for launch. At 5:45 a.m. on July 28th, the balloon was released. Seven hours into the flight, at an altitude of nearly 60,000 feet, the huge hydrogen balloon began to tear. Either a design or construction flaw caused some section of fabric to stick together and eventually rip under pressure. Kepner attempted a controlled descent, essentially using the torn balloon as a parachute, but eventually the entire balloon was in pieces. The crew had no choice but to bail out and rely on their own parachutes. The exit from the small hatch was clumsy, slow, and extremely risky. Kepner went first, bailing out at about 10,000 feet. Stevens bailed out at just 3,000 feet. The mission came to an end in a cornfield in south central Nebraska. Despite the nearly disastrous crash, the Explorer 1 flight was considered a success in terms of the information extracted from scientific instruments and film that survived the crash intact. The Army and the National Geographic Society were determined to try again. The Goodyear Zeppelin Company provided a larger balloon with slightly heavier fabric, a larger gondola and hatch, and one major difference. This balloon would be taken aloft by helium, not hydrogen. A launch attempt on July 12, 1935 was scrubbed when a safety feature on the balloon failed and the balloon could not be inflated. Goodyear fixed the problem, but it took months before another launch could be attempted. Finally, on November 11, 1935, Explorer 2 rose out of the Strato Bowl carrying Explorer 1 veterans Captains Albert Stevens and Orville Anderson. Explorer 2 reached a height of 72,395 feet, a world record that stood for 20 years until another balloon launched from South Dakota Strato Bowl beat it by less than 4,000 feet. The flight lasted 8 hours and 12 minutes. Stevens conducted some 60 scientific experiments, measuring radiation intensity, ozone concentrations, and collecting air samples from different altitudes, monitoring sun intensity, barometric pressure, temperature, and on and on. Captain Stevens also took dozens of photos, including this one showing a view of western South Dakota.
Where they reached the top, that photograph became an iconic photograph, and it shows the curvature of the Earth, and that was the first time they could really see the curvature of the Earth.
Despite all the time aloft, Explorer 2 never crossed South Dakota's borders. Anderson and Stevens landed uneventfully near White Lake, some 225 miles east of their launch site. A quarter century later, after Air Force Captain Joe Kittinger set a high-altitude parachute jump world record, diving from a helium balloon at an altitude of 102,800 feet, he gave credit to the accomplishments of the Explorer flights.
Little did we know that in a few years, man would fly in space, and then after another few years, that man would walk in the moon. But it all started right here in the Strato Bowl. Joe Kittinger.
There is a South Dakota connection to the helium balloon that lifted Joe Kittinger into the stratosphere in 1960 and to the balloon that lifted adventurer Felix Baumgartner to a high-altitude parachute jump record more than four decades later. Both balloons were designed and manufactured by Sioux Falls-based Raven Industry. The company was established in Sioux Falls in 1956 by four balloon engineers from Minneapolis. They named their company Raven Industries. Engineer and co-founder Ed Yost invented the hot air balloon, and the list of Raven's world records and accomplishments in hot air balloon aviation is long. For many years, Raven Industries was known as the world's premier manufacturer of parade balloons and especially of hot air sport balloons. Today, Raven is a diversified company, but they no longer make hot air sport balloons. One Raven division manufactures plastic and other films for use in various industries, including agriculture. Another specializes in precision ag technologies. The third division, known since 1986 as Raven Aerostar, continues to be a leader in high-altitude balloon technologies and continues the vision of the company's founders.
Raven's history is starting with stratospheric balloons. So doing scientific research, and that was really to prepare for supporting the space program.
Raven Aerostar balloons are still used for research and testing vital to space exploration.
As we've progressed, we've continued to work with NASA in testing space instruments that will be flown on spacecraft. So we'll test them first on a balloon, and they can get them up for a lot cheaper, test the instrument, make sure it can do what it needs to do in that environment.
Balloons have any number of uses, both military and civilian. They can be used for surveillance and to restore communications to areas hit hard by natural disasters. Raven Aerostar's high-altitude balloons might also one day make worldwide internet access possible.
Like a cell tower in the stratosphere. So you get it up at about 60,000 feet, and then you navigate up and down to maintain coverage over an area, and then you can basically have a cell tower that can be developed and delivered.
Raven's Jim Nelson says balloons can do what aircraft and some satellite technologies can do for a lot less money.
So having this capability that you can be like a satellite, like an airplane, where it can be tactical, where you can get up quickly and have an asset available, whether that's for agriculture or for the military or for infrastructure, having a capability that can go up and maintain coverage, rough coverage over an area for a period of time is very unique.
South Dakota has had a high profile in America's strategic defense since World War II. An air base built over the old Rapid City Airport was established as a training station for World War II pilots, but by the early 1950s, long-range bombers stationed at Ellsworth Air Force Base could deliver a nuclear strike anywhere in the world. The 44th Missile Wing was assigned to Ellsworth in 1961 with a mission to construct and control a significant portion of America's ballistic missile defense system. South Dakota, west of the Missouri River, was dotted with at least 150 missile silos, manned, guarded, and ready to strike or counterstrike. The rocket technologies required to deliver a bomb across oceans and continents began in World War II and advanced during the Cold War. Those advancements made the idea of putting satellites and maybe even humans into space seem within reach.
When you look at the development of the rockets back in the 50s and particularly the 60s, you can see it was absolutely astounding, the technological advancements in the short amount of time between each advancement.
America's best minds began to shift their focus from global annihilation to space exploration. Retired aerospace engineer and executive Lee Solid grew up on a farm near Martin, South Dakota, and is a 1959 graduate of the South Dakota School of Mines and Technology. California rocket manufacturer Rocketdyne had a job for him as a rocket test engineer as soon as he graduated.
They said, you know, we like to come out here and hire farm boys with engineering degrees. And the reason is obvious. They just assume that a farm kid has got a work ethic and, you know, got an understanding. You know, you operate under the authority in many cases, the authority of nature. I mean, you milk the cows when the cows need milking, not when you feel like milking them, you know.
Solid says growing up, he did all of the things that most South Dakota farm kids do. He happened to be a pretty good basketball player and earned a spot on the University of South Dakota team. But basketball wasn't in his future.
My decision to go become an engineer, I guess, really was accepting a challenge from my dad, who thought I needed to work a little harder. I was having too much fun at the university, and I didn't seem to have any direction, and he sensed that, and he makes me this challenge, so I took it and transferred to an engineering school, even then not knowing, you know, where does this all lead?
Lee Solid began his career by helping test the missile propulsion technologies that would lead to manned spaceflight. He worked with the German rocket scientists employed by the U.S. after World War II, including Wernher von Braun, designer of the V-2 rocket and the eventual architect of the Apollo program. Von Braun's role in World War II is still being scrutinized, but few questions were asked at the start of the U.S. space program.
Nobody talked about these things. It was never a part of the conversation.
Solid was also acquainted with the Mercury 7 astronauts, and he was present for the launches that put the first two Americans in space. He also worked on the Mercury Atlas rocket that sent astronaut John Glenn into orbit.
I was the engineer in the blockhouse for the company when we launched John Glenn. I consider that a high point of my whole career, being on the launch crew that put John Glenn into orbit, the first American.
Solid went on to work in the Gemini program and transitioned into the Apollo program, overseeing work on the engines powering the mighty Saturn series, which culminated in the Saturn V, the most powerful rocket ever built. Solid began his executive career at the end of the Gemini program. He was promoted to a senior executive position for Rocketdyne. His responsibilities evolved, but he saw the Apollo program through from beginning to end and worked in the shuttle program, overseeing construction and testing of the main engine. Solid remembers the successes of the missions and launches he worked on and witnessed, but he also remembers the tragedies of Apollo 1 and the Challenger and Columbia shuttles. It was his job to be present in the fire control room at the Kennedy Space Center for a lot of liftoffs, including the Challenger shuttle launch.
Of course, immediately in your mind, you know something's wrong. I mean, you know it's a bad day. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to have figured that out. You knew that we were in trouble. And as an engine guy, at that point in time of Challenger, I was still with Rocketdyne, and I was heading up the engine operation here. Our immediately thoughts, mine and my chief engineer was sitting with us, we immediately assumed that this tragedy had been initiated by an engine. I mean, as I've said before, an engine is a controlled explosion. Lose control and you got nothing but explosion. And so you automatically see it as the high risk element on the vehicle. But we can't help but think about, you know, how could an engine, which engine was it? What did we do during the processing? What did we forget to do during the processing? You know, we were having that kind of conversations, not only with ourselves, but to a degree with each other, even though it was a very quiet time. At its seeming right time, our data guy on the second floor managed to work his way up and open the door to the firing room and stick his arm through it and give us a high sign, give us a thumbs up. Now, us engine guys are the only ones in that room that probably knew, that even saw it, that knew what that meant. But what that meant was it wasn't an engine that caused this.
Lee Solid continues to live in Florida but has close ties to South Dakota and his family near Martin. He's been active in his community and helped get this Space Memorial Park built. It's a tribute and a place to remember the many men and women who have worked in the U.S. space program over the years. NASA aerospace engineer Scott Vongen is also a graduate of the South Dakota School of Mines and Technology. He's worked in various capacities at NASA since 1982.
This bright-eyed, bushy-tailed young engineer was told, you will be assigned scientific experiments, that you will be responsible from the principal investigators to help their team physically integrate them into the space lab and shuttle environment, electrically and software test them to verify the interfaces and the protocols necessary for them to be successful are met. And then, once that launches, to be a member of the science operations team to operate those missions through a successful mission and landing, and then returning the science instruments to the investigators.
Vonjen is also an astronaut. He's been through the application testing and training processes and was entirely prepared to fly.
The time that I was selected, interestingly enough, wasn't as a mission specialist, but as a payload specialist. And the difference between them is a mission specialist astronaut is a career astronaut. Once you're selected, you will fly multiple missions, you wear a NASA badge, and that's your job. A payload specialist, as the name suggests, is tied to a specific payload.
His status as an alternate payload specialist had him waiting in the wings. Later, he was in the rotation for a mission that was scrubbed.
One might say, and I can't validate this, I might be the most interviewed, trained, applied, non-flown astronaut. So, for what that's worth.
These days, Vonjen is part of a NASA team working on collaboration strategies with other nations interested in space exploration.
What type of habitats, what type of landers, what type of rovers and power systems and comm systems would we want to have? Again, a very large team looking and planning that.
Vonjen compares travel to the moon and beyond to a camping trip.
This time, not unlike Apollo, when we return to the moon, we want to set up sustainable activities. The way to think about it, if you're going to go camping for a month in the Grand Canyon, you might want to camp for a week in your backyard or the local, you know, county park to see that you're ready to go in your logistics. Same with the moon. If you can't sustain yourself on the moon, you probably aren't ready to prepare for Mars. So it's a logical progression.
South Dakota schools continue to graduate students in science, technology, engineering, and math, the so-called STEM fields. Desiree Wilson grew up in Hill City, South Dakota. She's just graduated with a Bachelor of Science in Geology. She's had NASA internships along the way. Now she's on the NASA payroll in Virginia.
I actually work for a department that oversees the website My NASA Data. It's an educational website that introduces data to ages or grades 3 through 12 students. And so it's all about engaging students with data literacy for science education.
Annika Swedland is graduating from Mines with a Bachelor of Science in Computer Engineering. She's going to work for a high-profile tech company with a space-based backbone.
I'll be working for Garmin in North Carolina, the Raleigh area. They work with smartwatches, fitness watches, with GPS devices, marine GPS navigating devices. I might work with those. I don't know exactly which part I'll be in yet, but I'm definitely going to be working for them. And so I'll be working on the embedded software engineering side of things.
South Dakota School of Mines is not the only state school graduating people in STEM fields. Jennifer Lacey is from Salem, South Dakota, and earned a degree in mathematics from the University of South Dakota. She went on to study geospatial science and engineering at South Dakota State. She's now the Observing Systems Branch Chief at the U.S. Geological Survey's Earth Resources Observation Satellite Center in Sioux Falls, known as EROS.
I oversee all of the satellite operations, which we currently have two satellites in operations, the development of new satellites, which we have one satellite that we're planning to launch in December 2020 that we're developing with NASA, and we're studying what future missions will happen beyond those existing satellites.
Getting into a tech career takes a lot of work and dedication. Government agencies and businesses that need educated workers recognize that, and some have set up programs to motivate and support students. The South Dakota Space Grant Consortium plays a key role.
South Dakota Space Grant Consortium is a NASA-funded program. It's one of 52 state-based consortia in the country. It's mainly a higher education program. Most of our funding goes to fund college students who are pursuing STEM degrees in fields that would interest NASA. But we also have a significant outreach to K-12 to go into the schools and talk to the kids about the various space missions and NASA missions and get them interested in sticking with their science and their math while they're yet in pre-college.
Sioux Falls tech company Raven Aerostar also supports STEM education in South Dakota.
There's so much talent in the state that we export. You know, they grow up, there's really talented people, and they think the only place to do aerospace or anything to do with high technology is you have to go to the East Coast, you have to go to Silicon Valley, and that's just not true. There really is exciting work that we do here in South Dakota, in Sioux Falls.
Jim Nelson could be a role model for some. He grew up on a farm near Irene, South Dakota, and earned a bachelor's degree at the University of Sioux Falls before going on to MIT. The U.S. Geological Survey's Aeros Center near Sioux Falls also offers support for South Dakota students interested in getting the education and the specific training they would need for a career at the center.
We really have a lot of educational partners that have built a workforce for us that other companies and businesses have been able to profit from.
The United States has set goals of returning to the moon and pushing on to Mars, but some of the most forward-looking space-related work is happening on the ground in South Dakota. The Aeros Data Center collects and archives satellite images from the so-called Landsat satellites, actually a series of satellites that have been orbiting the Earth in pairs since 1972. The satellites capture and transmit repetitive images of the Earth, essentially mapping and remapping any given spot on the planet over and over again. Researchers can use these repetitive images to record and analyze change over time. They can study changes in vegetation, water, and other natural resources, and they can see the effects of all kinds of both human and natural activities.
Part of what we try to do is not only map and monitor the change, but assess what are the drivers behind what's influencing those changes. It could be weather, it could be climate on a very longer term scale, could be socioeconomic drivers, you know, resource management, commercial forestry, agriculture, residential expansion.
Scientists at another research facility located nearly a mile underground in the Black Hills are exploring some of the great mysteries of the universe. The men and women working at the Sanford Underground Research Facility at the Old Homestake Gold Mine in Lead are trying to understand the nature of neutrinos, the most abundant particle in the universe and the most elusive. They are also trying to unlock the secrets of dark matter and energy. The science being done here could potentially change our understanding of how the universe really works, and maybe even help us understand what the universe really is.